You are watching No Filter with Debbie. I'm Debbie Schlossel, and these are my views and opinions. Welcome to No Filter with Debbie. I'm Debbie Schlossel, and you know what's driving me crazy? What's driving me crazy is Ice Cube. Yes, the anti-police, anti-Semitic, anti-white, racist, bigot, and rapper is now being embraced by President Trump, his campaign, and the Republican Party. It is amazing what people will do when they feel like they are desperate, which I don't think the president should be in a desperate position. You cannot believe the polls, and I believe he's going to pull this one out. But whether he will or whether he won't is irrelevant to the embrace of Ice Cube, aka O'Shea Jackson. Now, as you may recall, Ice Cube is famous for being in the group NWA, which stands for N-Words with Attitude. All right? They pioneered what's known as gangsta rap. They are a lowlife group. They glorified basically calling women bleeps and bleeps. I can't say either word on this show, but it rhymes with witches. And the other word is short for another word for prostitute. And they're lowlifes. And they're anti-cop. They support cop killers. They are part of the problem, not the solution. They were never part of the problem. So their hit was Bleep the Police. All right? Donald Trump should never, ever associate with any rappers who put out a song that's Bleep the Police. But yes, he did. And yesterday, Katrina Pearson, who is a Trump campaign official and spokesperson, you've probably seen her around. She was on the Trump campaign last time around, and before that, she worked for Ted Cruz and was part of his campaign. She is biracial, and she put out this tweet, shout out to Ice Cube for his willingness to step up and work with the real Donald Trump administration to help develop the Platinum Plan. Now, what is the Platinum Plan? It's this plan for Black Americans. And she says, leaders gonna lead, haters gonna hate. Thank you for leading. So who is she thanking for leading? Who's she calling a leader? The person that wrote and rapped Bleep the Police? That's who she's saying is a leader? Or is it President Trump for embracing the person who rapped Bleep the Police and is still making multi-millions of dollars a year off of that anti-cop song? Is that leadership? Is it hating? Are we haters because we point that out? And we say that this is outrageous and that President Trump should not reach out to lowlifes? Listen, I'm all for outreach. I'm all for outreach to the Black community. There are many Black Republicans, many Black Americans who are not Republicans who are supporting the president. A lot more than there were the last time around. You would be surprised. He's won a lot of people over. But never, ever, ever reach out to this person. So what I think is interesting is that this guy was anti-Semitic and anti-cop for decades, and he never apologized for it. In fact, he still has those points of view. And nobody ever cared about that. But now he's partnering with the Trump administration, and everyone is aghast. Not because President Trump is working with a known bigot, cop hater, and Jew hater. No, that's not why they're aghast. They don't care about that. That's okay with them. They're aghast that he's working with President Trump. President Trump is the bad guy in their eyes, not this lowlife thug. Yes, that's what he is. He's a thug. So Katrina Pearson tweets this out, never takes it back. President Trump doesn't take it back. I have to say, I'm very disgusted. You know what? You cannot be the law and order president yelling and screaming as you are and as you should be about the violence around America with the riots and the looting, which, by the way, is still going on in places like Portland, in Wisconsin, in places like Seattle, places like New York. They're just not showing it to you on the news because even they, the liberal media, have grown tired of it, or they just don't want Joe Biden to lose, and every time they cover it, it's bad for him. But still, you are the president that is saying you are for law and order, and you are partnering with this guy for your contract with Black Americans. Apparently, that was the I have to backtrack. The contract with Black Americans was something that Ice Cube created, which, by the way, is not something. If you go and look at it, some of the things are good, but some of the things are not anything the Trump administration should be embracing at all. But anyway, the Trump administration has a platinum plan for Black Americans. Why it's platinum and not gold and not just my plan for Black Americans, why it has to be a precious metal, I don't know. I don't know. I know Ice Cube and his ilk like to wear a lot of these precious metals around their neck as they yell and scream and rant and rap about Jews. Let me just tell you a little bit about Ice Cube. Besides his Bleep the Police rap, he also has a song called No Vaseline. I hesitate to call these songs. They're not songs. They're garbage. But he has a song, in quotation marks, called No Vaseline. And in it, he attacks Jews and he calls their former manager a white boy, Jew boy, cracker. A white cracker, a white Jew. And he attacks Jews. He also, on one of his album covers, when he left NWA and went out on his own, he posed with an anti-Semitic book from the Nation of Islam, from Louis Farrakhan, who is bigot extraordinaire, racist extraordinaire in the Black community, but embraced by them. One of the most popular figures in the Black community, but hates white people, hates Asians, hates every nationality that's not Black. And Ice Cube is a big acolyte of his. Ice Cube used Nation of Islam bodyguards. And Ice Cube had on the cover of his album a picture of himself posing with an anti-Semitic book that claims, and it's a widely debunked book, it's called The Secret History of Jews and Blacks. It's something like that. And it alleges that Jews were behind the slave trade. I'll tell you who was behind the slave trade. Muslims. Yes. Muslims, largely Arab Muslims, the Berber tribes, and so on in Africa, what they did was they kidnapped Blacks and they sold them into slavery. They subjugated them, they brought them here to the New World. They were the ones who were behind this. But Louis Farrakhan is a fake Muslim, a Black Muslim, and so he cannot come out and say, yes, it's my religion that is behind slavery, but it is. And you know what's the only religion today that still practices slavery? Islam. You know where there are still slaves in this world today? Black slaves? In the Islamic countries, in the Arab countries, in the Gulf. Yes, that's where they are. You won't hear anything about that from Ice Cube. And I just think it's a shame, it's a damn shame that the president has reached out to this person and sullied the White House with this Bleep the Police lowlife rapper. And, you know, we were talking about Louis Farrakhan. This week, it is the 25th anniversary of the Million Man March. That was the racist, bigoted march led by Louis Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam on the Washington Mall in 1995, yes, 25 years ago, where he basically told thousands, tens of thousands of Black men horrible things about white people, horrible things about Jews. By the way, the Minnesota Attorney General, he was Louis Farrakhan's right-hand man at that time, Keith Ellison, yep, at this racist, bigoted march. And people were there. People reported on it. Go look it up. Google the kinds of things that were said at this march. But we're supposed to celebrate this. This is on the cover today of USA Today newspaper. And this is the kind of people that O'Shea Jackson, a.k.a. Ice Cube, is all about. So, it's not haters gonna hate. People who are realists and who are worried about this kind of hatred taking over America are going to point this out. And it is very tragic when it comes to the Republican Trump White House. When we come back, we will talk about high tech. Jack Dorsey of Twitter and Facebook, they are censoring the news because they want to electioneer. We talked about this yesterday. There are new developments. That and more after we come back from these messages on No Filter with Debbie on Beck.
You just might find the home of your dreams this weekend by watching the Alliance Real Estate Tour of Homes Sundays at 6 p.m. and Wednesdays at 7 on Beck. Featuring properties from Bismarck, Mandan, Minot, and surrounding areas. The Alliance Real Estate Tour of Homes presents desirable properties that are for sale, lets you meet your Alliance realtors, and provides critical insights into local happenings from community and business leaders. Join us this Sunday evening at 6 or Wednesday at 7 for the Alliance Real Estate Tour of Homes on Beck.
Today's households have more digital devices than ever before. More links to family, business, education, and entertainment. Beck Communications spent over 10 years building North Dakota's fastest fiber optic internet service. Beck Lightband Internet, outpacing speeds in large cities nationwide. Lightband Internet handles all your digital needs without throttling your connection to the world. Beck Communications, valuable digital connections in rural North Dakota.
As the mayor of Bismarck, I invite you to join together today and stand united in the fight to prevent the spread of COVID-19. Case counts are steadily on the rise in the Bismarck-Mandan metro area, so please do your part. Protect yourself and others by wearing a mask when you're not at home. During the pandemic response, scientists have determined wearing a mask is a benefit to you and to those around you. This help keeps others from getting sick and may lessen the severity of illness if you are infected with COVID-19. We're all in this together. So let's get kids back to school, preserve our local economy, and keep our community strong. Let's show everyone how we come together to keep Bismarck the safe, resilient community we know and love. For more information, visit health.nd.gov/coronavirus. That's health.nd.gov/coronavirus.
Bismarck Central, 4800.
4800, go ahead.
Requesting social services on-call team.
Stand by. 4800 social services requesting additional information.
You can advise social services that we have a 18-month-old female who was in a residence with a mother, now being transported to medical care for overdose.
Welcome back to No Filter with Debbie on Beck. Now, yesterday we told you about a very, very, very important story about Joe and Hunter Biden that ran in the New York Post. There were actually two stories. The stories were the New York Post obtained a laptop that was apparently Hunter Biden's. It contained a lot of emails between himself and officials of Burisma and people connected with the Ukraine government. And he was talking about a meeting he was arranging with his father, and so on. There are many, many emails, and they only quoted some of them. There were two stories yesterday. I believe there is more follow-up today. But the bigger story is not even that. It's that Twitter and Facebook both censored the story. I tweeted that story out yesterday morning, and I showed you what happened yesterday afternoon when I tried to click on it again. I was going to print it out for the show. And when I clicked on it, Twitter warned me that it's harmful and damaging and that I might not want to click on it. They were censoring the article. But not only that, early in the morning when I had sent it out, I already out there was a tweet from an official of Facebook saying that they are going to deplatform this article. In other words, they are going to censor it. They are going to limit its distribution. This went out of the way of Facebook's normal policy. Facebook normally fact checks only 330 articles, I believe, since 2016, so about 100 articles per year, give or take. And normally, they only take the articles down after they fact checked them and found them to be false. And their so-called fact checking ain't no fact-checking. They have 50 mainstream media players that they have picked. Yes, some of them are conservative, but they're mainstream conservative, and these are all people that are interested in keeping their competitors out, keeping them down. So they get to decide if this article is true, which is not the way you do things. Don't let McDonald's and Burger King decide if Gus's burgers are okay to eat. You just don't do that. It's not how it works in a free market. Now, yes, Facebook's a private company, so is Twitter. But they've been given exemptions by Congress. Congress has said, oh, you are not going to be liable for anything that's published on your forums because you're just a neutral publisher. And we have made this law to make the internet free-flowing. But in fact, they're not neutral publishers. They are activists. They censor. They have editorial policies, basically. And they say, well, if it's conservative and it's against Joe Biden, we are going to put up these messages on Twitter. It might be harmful. Or if we're Facebook, we're going to say, we're limiting its distribution. You can't see this. We're going to have it fact-checked first. That's what they did with these New York Post articles. Now, what was the reasoning? Well, they claim that the laptop allegedly came from Rudy Giuliani. I don't care where it came from. If those weren't Joe and Hunter Biden's emails, why isn't either of them denying that they wrote those emails? They aren't. They've made a general denial of the story, but when they've been asked specifically about the emails, they won't respond. To the few media outlets that actually ask them. Most are lazy and won't ask because they'd rather just say, oh, it's not true. Oh, these are crazy people from the Trump campaign. So anyway, they censored this story. And Jack Dorsey then later on in the day sent out this tweet. Take a look at this. So our communication around our actions on the New York Post article was not great. And blocking URL sharing via tweet or direct message with zero context as to why we're blocking, unacceptable. So then he puts out this tweet below it about Twitter safety, that this is it's not safe, and we want to provide much-needed clarity. I don't need you to provide clarity to me if I want to read a New York Post article. Don't give me clarity. I don't need it. If I need it, I'll ask for it. And I ain't asking you, Jack Dorsey, who's a big liberal. No. Jack Dorsey, who, when I had tens and thousands of Twitter followers, kicked me off. Why? Because I said that Carrie Fisher was a bad role model for women and girls because she died as a drug addict, and that was not okay. Oh, also, I pointed out that Tracy Lords, who defended her and attacked me, and used obscene words to attack me and insulted my intelligence, I pointed out that she had been a porn star, which all true. But I got kicked off of Twitter as a hate group, so I have to start all over again. I only have a few hundred followers now because of that. I'm going to build back up. I just started back up recently. But this is how they work. They don't like your opinion. They deplatform you. They kick you out. They don't like articles that tell the truth. And they put up all these things. Jack Dorsey's tweet saying, oh, we didn't do this the right way. No, no, you shouldn't have done it at all. Stay away. You want neutrality from Congress? Earn it. Be neutral. And they're not. So now two Republican senators have called for them to come before Congress. They have subpoenaed Jack Dorsey and called for him to testify, or they're going to subpoena him. And they're probably going to do the same for Mr. Zuckerberg of Facebook, as they well should. Both of these men should be forced to answer. So should Google. So should many of these other tech giants who are trying to squelch legitimate debate, trying to electioneer and engineer the vote. And this is nothing new. I want you to take a look at, and I'm going to get to another story. You know what, before I get to that, let's get to this other story and then I'll show you how this is nothing new. Another tech giant, Amazon. Listen to what they're doing. So Shelby Steele, this is a tremendous scholar, Shelby Steele, very well known in conservative circles, frequent contributor to the Wall Street Journal. I respect this man immensely. This guy is brilliant. He also happens to be black. He and his son, Eli Steele, made a documentary called Who Killed Michael Brown? And so they explore all these media narratives about Michael Brown. You know, you've probably seen Michael Brown signs at all of these protests. Michael Brown was not like George Floyd. Michael Brown was not like Breonna Taylor, although we've gone through both of those cases and pointed out some of the things that the media doesn't want you to know. Michael Brown shoplifted at a store, and then he attacked a police officer, and it was either him or Officer Darren. That officer would have died if Michael Brown would have gotten his gun. He was going to kill him. It was either one guy or the other. So who should have lived? The cop defending himself or the criminal thug? The criminal thug, Michael Brown, should have died. And this documentary explores that and race in America. So what is happening? Shelby Steele and his son Eli have been deplatformed from Amazon. Amazon is rejecting streaming this. That is outrageous. I mean, that is just censorship. And they don't cite anything objectionable in this because there isn't. Listen, Shelby Steele is not like me. This guy speaks the Queen's English to a fault. He is an intellect of intellects. He speaks like you would expect from somebody that lives in a library filled with dusty leather books and who reads and writes treatises. There's nothing wrong with this documentary. They just don't want you to see it. They don't want you to know the facts. So Amazon rejected them. One last thing about this. So this is nothing new. Big tech, electioneering, and helping politicians. Check out this picture, and I'll tell you who this is. Check out this picture of Steve Schmidt from Google. Check this out. Do we have that picture? Look at that. So Steve Schmidt, the CEO, or was then the CEO of Google, look at him. He's wearing Hillary credentials at the 2016 Democratic election. That was at her 2016 victory party that turned out to be a loser's party. So as you can see, he's smiling. That was before she lost, like later in the night when everyone was crying. But look at him. He is wearing a staff badge that says Election Day, November 2016, Eric Schmidt. Sorry, not Steve Schmidt. Forgive me. Eric Schmidt. Look at him. He is in for Hillary. This is the CEO at the time of Google. They're in bed with each other. And Kamala Harris, she and her husband own hundreds of thousands of dollars in tech stock. A lot of her staffers work for these tech companies. And one of her former spokespeople works for Facebook, I believe it is. They work for these tech companies. These groups, the Liberal Democrat campaigns and these tech companies, they are incestuous. When we come back, we will talk about tonight's dueling town halls between Trump and Biden, or I guess against each other. More after these messages on No Filter with Debbie on Beck.
Is your business phone system outdated and expensive to maintain? Most large VoIP companies leave you on hold or struggling through online support and training for your employees. With Beck Connect, you always have fast, friendly, local support. Familiar faces with the know-how to keep you connected. Take advantage of the newest technology in voice calling, video conferencing, and virtual meeting rooms. Beck Connect gives you all the features you need with no upfront investment and no obsolete hardware or software ever again. Simplify your communications. Choose local. Choose Beck Connect.
Everybody needs an off-season, but our announcers have a tough time slowing down.
Incredible! For the second time today, Brent has jammed the printer.
Really tough time.
He swiftly brings it down the lane, and he carries it down the stairway. And he finishes with a slam!
He once won a spelling bee in an ancient language that he did not speak. He is the only man to ever earn extra credit on an IQ exam. His academic degrees are considered legitimate spending currency in 22 nations, two principalities, and at Chick-fil-A restaurants in the United States and Western Canada.
I do not always engage with education programming, but when I do, it is the Dr. Duke Show.
Stay educated with the Dr. Duke Show, weekdays at 4 p.m. on Beck News.
Introducing Accord Comfort Sleep Systems, a better way to sleep. We offer you five different models to give you the perfect choice of support and body comfort. Every model begins with our exclusive Accord Comfort Reflex Layer. This ensures proper spinal alignment and a deep down body relief. Our 8-inch Whisper Breeze provides a medium firm feel, and our 10-inch Gentle Night model has a quilted top, giving you a medium plush comfort. both use Outlast fabric on the top of your mattress, ensuring that your body temperature is not too hot and not too cold. Our Copper Rest Sleep Series is our premier mattress, offering your choice of firm, plush, and luxury plush. Every model uses copper-infused gel latex and provides all the health benefits of copper. Accord Comfort mattresses are handcrafted in the USA and come with a 60-night sleep guarantee. You're going to love sleeping with us. Order today exclusively at AccordSleep.com or Tom's Home Furnishings in beautiful downtown Harvey.
You're looking for secure private cloud storage, but who can you trust? Big tech companies don't always keep your family photos, videos, and sensitive business information away from prying eyes. Your local Beck Lightband Internet Services comes with 50 gigs of Beck Cloud Backup, free. Hometown service with top-tier security to keep your data truly safe and private. Get your 50 gigs free today. Call 701-475-2361 and ask about Beck Cloud Backup.
Welcome back to No Filter with Debbie on Beck. Breaking news alert, Steve Scully. Do you remember that name? We talked about him a few days ago. He was supposed to be hosting the second presidential debate between Joe Biden and Donald Trump. And then after the debate was canceled, or around that time, it came out that he had tweeted to Anthony Scaramucci, the never Trumper, who was President Trump's, I think, shortest-lived employee, or one of them. He lasted 11 days as the director of White House communications, and he became a never-Trumper. He was fired after 11 days because he gave a series of embarrassing, ridiculous interviews attacking fellow Trump administration officials, attacking other people, and just basically being out there and not very impressive. So that's why he was fired. Then he tried to make a go of it as a reality star, but he is a campaigner against Trump. He's working with the Biden campaign. And Steve Scully sent him a tweet saying, should I respond to Trump? And I think this was because Steve Scully apparently screwed up, didn't know how to use direct messenger on Twitter to direct message him so nobody else would see it. So the whole world saw it. He claimed his account was hacked. Nobody in the world believed him, because why would anybody hack his account to do that? What would be the motive? What would be the upside? What would they get out of it? Nobody believed him. And of course, he was discovered by C-SPAN. Did I say ESPN? C-SPAN. Same difference in my opinion. One is sports and the other one is sports for ugly people. But anyway, C-SPAN fired him, or they say indefinitely suspend him. I don't think he's really fired. We'll see. You know what? If he were conservative, he'd be out of there. If he said something about black people, he'd be out of there. If he was found direct messaging somebody in public and not actually using direct messenger to spread conservative messages, goodbye. But he is a liberal. He is a Biden supporter. We showed pictures, I think, of him at a Biden beach party fundraiser in, was it 2016, I think it was. And we also showed that he was, or we talked about, he was a Biden intern as well. I think he may keep his job, but he was found to be lying. He was not hacked. He made it all up. He did actually send that tweet to Scaramucci. And so he's been suspended indefinitely by C-SPAN. So, Steve Scully, it's been nice knowing you. Hopefully, we don't see you again in the position of an independent media figure. You are no such thing. Now, tonight is the big series, not series, I guess the big two dueling town halls between Trump and Biden. So, Joe Biden originally was supposed to have this town hall tonight with George Stephanopoulos, I believe, on ABC News. And then Donald Trump, you gotta love him for doing this. He and his campaign, they went silently under the radar, and they got NBC to agree to do a town hall with Trump at the exact same time, which you know what's gonna happen. This is gonna suck the life out of Joe Biden's town hall. Nobody's gonna watch that, nobody. If there are commercials, and usually they don't have commercials on these things, But if there are commercials, then I'll watch the Biden debating himself and trying to remember who he is on the ABC town hall. But the Trump town hall is what I'll be watching. You know it's what you'll be watching. And it's hosted by Savannah Guthrie. So what is going to happen tonight? I'll tell you what's going to happen. Both of these candidates are going to try and seal the deal. You know, these are the closing argument days. We are less than 3 weeks before the election. I think 3 weeks was Tuesday, so a couple days ago. And now we are almost there. So what is going to happen? Well, I'll tell you. Closing arguments. I hope President Trump is more disciplined. They said that at his Florida rally the other night, he was more disciplined. Supposedly he's meeting Florida voters undecided at this town hall. And we'll see. Today, he went on an epic two-minute rant on video against, or it was audio and video. I don't know. Maybe it was on the radio, but it was a two-minute rant against Savannah Guthrie, Lester Holt, and a whole bunch of the NBC News cast of characters. So, what is going to happen now that he is basically going to be on stage with these people, with Savannah Guthrie, who he attacked? He attacked her. It's going to be fun. I am excited. So closing arguments, what are they going to say? I'll tell you, we all know they're both going to be asked about coronavirus. President Trump is going to be asked the same old tired questions about, why didn't you tell us earlier? You knew. Bob Woodward said so. You told Bob Woodward. Why didn't you tell us earlier so we could go buy toilet paper earlier and clean out the shelves earlier? You could have saved lives. And he's going to respond back. Joe Biden is going to say, if I were president, I would have told people earlier. I would have had a plan. I would have had a national lockdown and shut down America forever. I would have a national mask mandate. I would destroy America. I mean, basically, he's going to give that plan, which we all know would do those things. He may be asked, let's hope, because you know what happens at these town halls. These town halls are supposed to be undecided voters, but we know what happens. The Donald Trump town halls are not undecided voters. They're Biden voters that have come to torture him and attack him. The undecided voters at the Biden town halls are Biden voters. They've already decided. They've come to give him softball questions. I hope this isn't more of the same at both of these, because if it is, it's going to be a snooze fest. It's not going to do anything. Now, will either of these change anybody's mind? Probably not, but you never know. You know what? There are some people who really don't decide what they're going to do until right before the election. And those are the people that President Trump needs. Now that we know that over 15, 16 million Americans have already voted, and many of those are Democrats, most of those probably. But don't let that scare you. Like I said the other day, those are people who would be going to the polls on election day. They're just voting early. So tonight, sealing the deal, making these final arguments, why you should pick me over the other guy. I really hope Trump does what I think he should. You might not like me. You might think I'm a terrible person. But if you like what my policies, that's what we're talking about. It's not a popularity contest. I'm not out to be Miss America or Miss Congeniality. I'm out to continue the great things I've done as president before COVID. You will see those again. That's what he needs to say. Joe Biden, I don't know what he's going to say. I really don't care, but I will report back on it tomorrow. When we come back, we will talk more about the heightened threat assessment in 16 counties in North Dakota and some changes at some of the North Dakota schools, that and more after these messages on No Filter with Debbie on Beck.
As the mayor of Bismarck, I invite you to join together to get our kids back to school, preserve our local economy, and keep Bismarck safe, strong, and resilient. A community task force has been launched to slow the spread of COVID-19 in our community. We're all in this together. Protect yourself and others by doing your part. Wear a mask when you're out and about, and slow the spread of COVID-19. For more information, visit health.nd.gov/coronavirus.
I just went in for a regular mammogram and I found out that I had a little tumor.
Through the exam and the biopsy, it was determined that I have cancer.
I got a call
from one of my doctors that I was diagnosed with breast cancer.
After 5 years, they found a local reoccurrence.
The first thing you hear when you're told you have a cancer, it's a little daunting because you don't know where to go with it.
Since 1999, in a partnership between CHI St. Alexius Health and Sanford Health Bismarck, the Bismarck Cancer Center has provided the most advanced radiation therapies and holistic support services for cancer patients and their loved ones for 20 years.
I've been at the Bismarck Cancer Center since it started. I actually was in the basement of Med Center 1 before, when we had old machines and old equipment. And thankfully, the two hospitals at the time, St. Alexis and Med Center 1, joined forces to create the Bismarck Cancer Center.
I walk in the door, I get nothing but hugs, and I was marveled at them. I mean, I thought it was the best place in the world.
The staff is unbelievably compassionate, and they explain everything to you.
Everybody's genuinely concerned about your well-being, and the level of care is just top notch. The Cancer Center just does such an amazing job of helping people.
To me and my family, the Cancer Center means life. It's given me the ability to live out my life with my family, my wife, my children, my grandchildren.
Because of them, I'm 2 years out. I get to move on with my life, make a difference now for other people.
I would recommend this center because the minute you walk through that door, they've got your back.
This center means so much to me and to the people that are in this building, and we just want to keep giving it back to the community and providing for them what they need.
I'm Katie. I've been cancer-free for 2 years.
I'm Steve, and I've been cancer-free for 4 years.
I've been cancer-free for 10 years.
10 years.
11 years.
15 years.
My name is Lainey, and I've been cancer-free for 18 years.
Bismarck Cancer Center, your partner against cancer for 20 years.
Welcome back to No Filter with Debbie on Beck. Yesterday we told you that Governor Burgum raised the threat level for COVID in 16 of North Dakota's counties to orange. And that means that in many cases, there are going to be more and more urgings of you, more and more insistences that you wear a mask. They're going to urge businesses, please limit yourself to only this amount, 25% or 50%, depending on what kind of business it is, of your capacity. Fortunately, though, these are only suggestions. It's not the law. There's no mask mandate, and these businesses are not mandated to basically amputate themselves and out of existence, because that's what it would do. A lot of these businesses are struggling anyway. And we feel sorry for all the people in North Dakota who lost loved ones. But as we have said before, the number of deaths in North Dakota is about 410,000. All right? It's not even 1%. It's like a fraction of a fraction of a fraction. It's very low. If you are family members of those people, we feel for you and our hearts go out to you and we're sorry. But it is statistically insignificant. It does not mean we should shut down North Dakota or listen to anything the national media is saying. Let me just tell you what's going on. 44 states in America have a rise in cases. 44 states. You know which state is not among them right now? Maybe it's only based on yesterday to today or 2 days ago to yesterday, but I saw a map this morning on ABC News and it showed South Dakota was not there. South Dakota has been mentioned over the last few days as being a state with increases, but over the last, I guess, day or two, they didn't have increases. But you know what? Every state is having increases. Every state, like 44 states. So there are very few that aren't. Many, many of those states, as I have pointed out, had very strict mask mandates. California, New York, Wisconsin. Wisconsin Governor Tony Evers just lost today, and we'll tell you about that later on in the show. But Wisconsin had a very strict mask mandate. They had a very strict policy about bars and restaurants and the restrictions. It does not work. So this media that is clamoring for North Dakota to have these mask mandates, it's absurd. And you know who else is clamoring for this and who has gotten involved in this hysteria? The doctors. Now listen, I respect medicine. I respect men of science and medicine. My late father was an ophthalmologist. He was an MD. And I believe in medicine and science. That's all we have. But doctors are not our elected officials. There are some doctors who happen to be elected officials. And that's great. But we elected in North Dakota a governor. We elected a legislature. They're the ones who make the rules. Now, if we want to consult doctors to find out what is the best science and the best medicine, we can do that. But governors and the legislature are who we elected to set the policy. And Governor Burgum is doing the right thing here. He is the one we elected to decide what to do. We've known for 7 months what can happen, how to comport ourselves with that. There is no reason to have mask mandates. But yet you have 65 pediatricians, and I think it's something like 100 doctors of other specialties who have written letters. The 65 pediatricians were begging people to be more careful and to the governor to do something. The 100 other doctors were begging for a mask mandate. No, you are not our elected leaders. You are just people who treat the ill. You don't really know more than most people because, again, as we have said on this show over and over and over again, there are no long-term studies. Nobody really knows. And they've been giving us so many mixed messages, whether it is on masks, whether you can get reinfected, whether you can catch this from surfaces, whether 6 feet is enough, whether it could go 13 feet or 30 feet in the air, whether you should wear a mask outside. There are all of these conflicting, constant statements. Nobody knows. And we won't know for a very, very long time. So, Governor, keep what you're doing. Urging people is one thing. Making it the law is entirely another. Now, with regard to that, a lot of North Dakota institutions have reacted. So, Bismarck Schools. Bismarck Public Schools were going to be returning all of the students back to school eventually, and they have halted the return of grades 6 through 9 to return to face-to-face instruction. And that's too bad, because I think that this should be the way of life. You should reopen America, go back to school. Everybody knows what they need to do. I mean, we talked about these schools. They were making kids carry their backpacks full of books all around because their lockers might have germs. Well, guess what? If they do, the floors might have germs, the air might have germs. Some of these things that they're doing just don't make sense. And I believe that not returning these kids grade 6 to 9 to school doesn't make sense either. Kids are not likely to be infected. They're not even likely to spread the disease. As we pointed out, there was a Princeton University study. There was also a USA Today analysis of Florida high schools. And they both found that schools elementary through 12th grade are not, kindergarten through 12th grade, are not super spreaders. We know that. So they shouldn't be doing this. And on a related note, what they also shouldn't be doing is fans are no longer allowed at Fargo and West Fargo public school sporting events. That's ridiculous. Some of these things, a lot of these things are outdoors. You're not going to spread this outdoors. That doesn't happen. There is the air, there's breezes. You know, if you're really worried about it, do some social distancing. That is just not necessary. So the Fargo Public Schools, only athletes, coaches, and essential personnel will be allowed at games. Great. So parents don't get to see their kids play. Kids don't get to have their parents there for moral support. Not good. This is not good for America. Stop the hype and the hysteria. The sky is not falling. Now, this is interesting. So, you know, North Dakota has a reputation as a nice state, North Dakota nice. But a recent survey found that 36% of North Dakotans are likely to leave frequent negative online reviews if they receive poor service or poor product. Now, you know what? North Dakota only ranks 16th in this. So there are 15 other states that are meaner. There's nothing wrong with leaving a bad review. If services, if companies, if products are bad, you should tell the public. Now, I personally don't like to leave negative reviews. I've left very, very few. Why? Because I feel like somebody can have a bad day, something can be screwed up, and you know what? I give them a second chance, sometimes a third chance, especially now when businesses are struggling to survive. Be careful before you leave a negative review. It hurts people. It takes jobs. It steals businesses. It makes them shut down. Don't do that unless it's well deserved. One last thing before we go to break. Enbridge. This is a great story for North Dakota. Enbridge finished the 12-foot portion of Line 3 that is in North Dakota. This employed 400 North Dakotans to do it. This is great. So we know Enbridge, like the Dakota Access Pipeline, faces lots of ongoing lawsuits. It has had lawsuits. We need oil flowing across America. We're not going to be plugging in our cars overnight and making all of America run out of electric power. We run on fuel. This is a good thing, and it employed North Dakota workers. Keep it coming. Keep that oil flowing. When we come back, a date has been set for Amy Coney Barrett's confirmation and some other things in the news after these messages on No Filter with Debbie on Beck.
You just might find the home of your dreams this weekend by watching the Alliance Real Estate Tour of Homes Sundays at 6 p.m. and Wednesdays at 7 on Beck. Featuring properties from Bismarck, Mandan, Minot, and surrounding areas, the Alliance Real Estate Tour of Homes presents desirable properties that are for sale, lets you meet your Alliance Realtors, and provides critical insights into local happenings from community and business leaders. Join us this Sunday evening at 6 or Wednesday at 7 for the Alliance Real Estate Tour of Homes on Beck.
Today's households have more digital devices than ever before. More links to family, business, education, and entertainment. Beck Communications spent over 10 years building North Dakota's fastest fiber optic internet service, Beck Lightband Internet, outpacing speeds in large cities nationwide. Lightband Internet handles all your digital needs without throttling your connection to the world. Beck Communications, valuable digital connections in rural North Dakota.
He once won a spelling bee in an ancient language that he did not speak. He is the only man to ever earn extra credit on an IQ exam. His academic degrees are considered legitimate spending currency in 22 nations, two principalities, and at Chick-fil-A restaurants in the United States and Western Canada.
I do not always engage with education programming, but when I do, it is the Dr. Duke Show.
Stay educated with the Dr. Duke Show, weekdays at 4 p.m. on Beck News.
Beautiful day to get out on the course, isn't it, Corey?
Without a doubt, Brian, and Scotty here was thinking the exact same thing.
There's a lot on the line for him today. He told his friends he's a scratch golfer, but the numbers today suggest otherwise. Ooh, swing and a miss.
Looks like he's excited to find that Titleist. Unfortunately, he was playing with mojos.
Ooh, and a major infraction just occurred. Can we get another look at that?
As from my angle, it looks like he's got about a 10, 12-foot putt slightly.
As the mayor of Bismarck, I invite you to join together to get our kids back to school, preserve our local economy, and keep Bismarck safe, strong, and resilient. A community task force has been launched to slow the spread of COVID-19 in our community. We're all in this together. Protect yourself and others by doing your part. Wear a mask when you're out and about, and slow the spread of COVID-19. For more information, visit health.nd.gov/coronavirus.
Trusting your digital life to faceless tech giants can be risky. Will they keep your family and business information truly safe from prying eyes? If you subscribe to local Beck Lightband Internet Service, you already have Beck Cloud Backup. Beck Cloud Backup is the safest, most private cloud storage for all your family memories, schoolwork, and business documents. Call 701-475-2361 to start using your free space on Beck Cloud Backup today.
Welcome back to No Filter with Debbie on Beck. Now, you might have heard about this controversy. Actress Gal Gadot, you know her as Wonder Woman, the latest incarnation of Wonder Woman. She was cast as Cleopatra, and you see in the picture there, a previous Cleopatra, Elizabeth Taylor, the lovely and beautiful late actress. And apparently there should have been the same outrage and uproar against Elizabeth Taylor as there now is against Gal Gadot. Gal Gadot is Israeli, she is Jewish, and she is apparently not wanted to be Cleopatra by some Muslim Arab commentators and by some black commentators. They claim that Cleopatra was black, she was African, she was Egyptian, and so on. Now, yes, Cleopatra was Egyptian, but it was the ancient Egyptian. They were not Africans. Yes, Egypt was in Africa, but the actual Cleopatra was a Ptolemaic Egyptian. In other words, she was a descendant of Ptolemy, who was a companion of Alexander the Great. So she was Macedonian Greek. She was not black. She was not African. She was Macedonian Greek. She was white European. So Gal Gadot is just fine being cast that way. You know, and it's always interesting. They always get upset when Europeans are cast as something they claim is African. But when Africans are cast as something that was white, that are real people, nobody gets upset. This is just ridiculous. It's acting. Acting means you play something you are not. But in this case, Cleopatra was not, is not, black or African. She is, or even Arabic. She was Macedonian Greek. Now, I am no fan of Gal Gadot because Gal Gadot is a far leftist. A lot of people in Israel are proud of her, but in fact, she has publicly attacked the Israeli army for trying to keep the peace and keep security in Israel. She has attacked the Israeli government for the same thing. She has starred in openly anti-Israel and anti-Jewish movies. There's a movie called Triple Nine, which is absolutely outrageous. It is it's a Protocols of the Elders of Zion, which is an anti-Semitic book. It's a modern-day version of that, and she willingly starred in it for a paycheck. So I'm not a big fan, but still, the truth has to be told when this political correctness shades it over in gray. The fact is, Cleopatra was not, is not, and will never be a minority. She just wasn't. Now, on to Mark Kelly, and speaking of minorities, he has a spokesperson named TJ, I think I'm pronouncing this correctly, TJ LaRue. And TJ LaRue sent out a tweet calling the police worthless bleeping pigs. Worthless, so the word duck, all right, it rhymes with that. Worthless bleeping pigs. Senator Mark Kelly, who claims he's pro-police, who's running for the U.S. Senate from Arizona, wants to be the next senator from there. And his spokesperson is calling the police worthless bleeping pigs. So everybody's saying, oh, well, that was so long ago and well before he was hired. It wasn't long ago. It was not when this guy was in high school or college. It wasn't years ago. Guess when it was? It was in August, a week before he was hired by this guy. It was in August. That's 2 months ago. That wasn't that long ago. 2 months ago, less than 2 months ago, this man's spokesperson, Mark Kelly's spokesperson, called the police worthless bleeping pigs. And you know what happened to him? Was he forced to resign? Was he indefinitely suspended like Steve Scully? Did anything like that happen? Nope. He just got to apologize because he's a minority. Minorities get away with this kind of thing. You know, we saw this with Deshaun Jackson. We told you about that when he talked about the Jews and attacked them and supported Hitler. We saw this. We see this with Ice Cube being embraced by the Trump White House. And now we see this with Mark Kelly running for the U.S. Senate. Now, this is a great story. So this Anchorage police, this Anchorage CBS reporter, I believe she's CBS. She is a reporter, TV reporter. I gotta read you the details of this because this is really interesting. The mayor of Anchorage, Alaska, Ethan Berkowitz, resigned. Why did he resign? He was having an affair with a news anchor named Maria Athens. That's her picture. Very beautiful. And both of them were married. They were having an affair. And what's very interesting is that she was covering him. She never disclosed to the public, I'm sleeping with this man. I have a relationship with him. She never did until he dumped her. And then when he dumped her, she blackmailed him. Apparently, she found out that he was posting nude photos on some underage website. So now they're both in trouble. She got arrested. She became nuts. She was ordered not to be in her studio. These are the media that are covering your stories. And remember, things are not always as they seem. And I'll see you tomorrow.